Please rise. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text for this morning is the Gospel as was read earlier, with an emphasis on the following verses. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Here ends our text. You may be seated. After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and people and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb." This is how St. John reveals the image of heaven as it was revealed to him. That multitude he sees is all who have been connected to God through faith in Christ, and all who have died in that faith, including those whom the Lord has called home this year: Harold Schweier, Dolores Shum, Eugene Sauway, and James Shum. In the baptismal rite, there's a place for pastor to give the person being baptized a white garment. And this white garment symbolizes both the new creation in the sacrament and points us to our final resting place in that great multitude before the throne of God and the Lamb, worshiping Him for all eternity. And in that multitude, we wear that white robe which was given to us, that white robe which was washed pure white in the blood of the Lamb who was sacrificed for us. Later in Revelation, John tells us that there is a new Jerusalem. And in that new Jerusalem, there is no temple, because the temple is the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb. Now that "and" there isn't telling us that there's two new temples in the new Jerusalem. There's not one for God and one for the Lamb. That "and" is telling us that God and the Lamb are connected. There is one temple in ancient Jerusalem, and one temple in the New Jerusalem, because God and the Lamb are one. We confessed this earlier in the Nicene Creed when we said that Jesus is of one substance with the Father. And that's true, because the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit are all one. However, there was a time in which the Son was separated from the Father. Jesus tells us this much when on the cross he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When he was lifted up, he drew all men to himself. On the cross, he drew the sins of all men to himself. The sinless one became sin in place of the sinner and put himself in that separation of God which we deserve. And in that moment of separation, Christ completed the goal of the Father. At his death, Christ cries out the word "Tetelestai." It is finished. Now that word "Tetelestai" is a word that focuses on the result of the action which is being performed. Because in his death, Christ has completed the will of the Father. He is the ultimate sacrifice to atone for the sins of the people. In his death, Christ died to conquer death, which are the wages of sin. For those who have died in the faith, there is no sting to death, because they do not suffer the eternal death. But as anyone who's ever lost a loved one here on earth can tell you, those who the loved one leaves behind, there's definitely a sting for them. Because you can no longer go to that person for advice or confide in them what your troubles are, or even just spend time with them as friends do. Following the death of a loved one, there is a hole in your temporal world which can never truly be filled. And that sting you feel, that loneliness, that something's missing, that's a tool of Satan trying to get us to blame God for the loss of our loved one and to decry his name. But when you feel that sting of losing that loved one, there really is only one response. Alleluia! Christ is risen! Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. For the story does not end on Calvary. The women come on the morning of the first day of the week, and the tomb is empty. In his resurrection, Christ is again one with the Father. He has taken on that sin, defeated that sin, and no longer stands separate, but is reunited. We will suffer the little death, the eternal or the temporal death. But just as Christ was raised from death into life, we will be too. On the last day, all people will be raised bodily, and all who are righteous on account of Christ will enter into that eternal life, joining in that multitude, praising God and the Lamb. We will be reunited with Harold and Dolores and Jean and Jim and all of our loved ones who have been called home from this vale of tears. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted in the reunion with their sainted loved ones. Today's gospel lesson is a passage known commonly as the Beatitudes, where Christ speaks of blessings different groups of people will receive. But these blessings are only imparted on those people on account of the death which Christ died in our place. The first blessing goes to those who are poor in spirit. Now, our minds like to think of those who are poor in spirit as being those who have no knowledge of the saving grace of the Father. They are indeed poor in spirit. But the poor in spirit which Christ speaks of here are those whose spiritual accounts lack the funds to pay off that balance. We have nothing of ourselves which can do the work which Christ did for us. Our spirit is not just poor, it's flat broke. Yet on account of what Christ did for us, our spiritual coffers are overflowing. We are indeed blessed. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. But the kingdom of heaven is not the reward. The blessing is the reward. In Matthew, the phrase "the kingdom of heaven" is referring to Christ. It's one of his titles. So the poor in spirit are blessed because they have Christ. And when you think about it, this section called the Beatitudes should honestly be called the Because of Christ, because all of the blessings imparted are because of him. Those who are merciful are shown mercy because of Christ. Those who hunger and thirst for righteousness are filled with Christ. And the peacemakers are called the sons of God because of Christ. And all of this culminates in the final blessing. Blessed are you whenever they mock you or persecute you or say evil things against you falsely because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. Here, Christ makes a small grammatical shift, which really reveals what he's talking about. You are blessed because of Christ, and your reward is great in heaven. Harold was blessed. Dolores was blessed. Jean was blessed. Jim was blessed. And all of them are now enjoying their great reward in heaven, worshiping before the throne of God and the Lamb. But you don't have to suffer your temporal death to enjoy that reward, because your reward is here and now as well. The reward was given to you when God put his name on your forehead. In your baptism, you were marked. You were set aside as one who partakes of that great heavenly reward. That reward was given to you again this morning when Pastor stood in place of God and forgave you of all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. For in that new Jerusalem, there is no curse. There is no night. There is no darkness. There is only the pure light which shines on you from the Lamb. And you will taste that reward today when we join in with Harold and Dolores and Jean and Jim and with the angels and with the archangels and with all of the company of heaven, lauding and magnifying his glorious name and partaking of the Lamb's victory feast for the forgiveness of your sins. Brothers and sisters in Christ, today we celebrate the reward which was prepared for all of those who were but sojourners and strangers in this vale of tears, but have now been called home to heaven. And these travelers confessed the saving name of God before God and man, and are now blessed with a rest from the trials and the tribulations of this world, and from their labors within the church militant. But if you're like me, today is a day where you think of those who are no longer with us. But blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. So today, and any day when you mourn, take comfort, for Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Amen. May the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus unto your eternal reward, life everlasting. Amen.